a lot of momentum going forward on this record. What inspired you to make Bad Mode, and how did you know it was time to collect your thoughts?
Someone told me recently that I always say, when this album is done, I'm going to take a little break. And then, you know, and I was saying that again, and she told me, well, you always say that, but then you always end up like doing one song here and there right afterwards, and then you're into the next album. And I thought, okay, that's actually true. I think I take a lot of time to make songs, and I can only make a song when there's something that I really need to write about.
Yeah, there's a lot of moving material. There's a lot of moving words and a lot of sort of growth in this record. I mean, first of all, just the sound of it, right? It's like bangers you can cry to.
Oh, thank you. That's a great compliment.
And I get the impression that you don't do too much conscious thinking about the way you create art. But for you to sort of get to that place, you must have had a feeling of how you wanted it to sound. And I mean, it's a dance record. It's an emotional dance record.
I don't usually have a concept going into making songs for an album, and it's something that becomes more evident as I write more songs. But this time, from the beginning, I knew that I wanted more electronic sounds. I really wanted to go back to the more programming and working with other people to make something a little bit, just to make sounds from zero and to make something that sounds a bit stranger sonically. Well, I guess the last three I did with Floating Points. And I remember just in the, before being completely done, and like when I was, you know, working on the songs, and I would, you know, work with him in his studio and then go home, and it would be late, but I would still listen to the song we're working on, and I would end up dancing in my kitchen for like an hour. That's really fun.
In the last couple of years, I've had several friends of mine and artist friends of mine come out and identify as non-binary. And I thought, you know, when you decided to, and I asked them the same question, and I hope you don't mind me asking you, for people who are trying to identify in that way and aren't sure how they know, how did you know that this was something that you wanted to make public and ultimately adopt in terms of your growth?
When I came across the term non-binary for the first time, which was, I guess, a few years ago, it wasn't a question of am I or am I not. It was like, whoa. Where was this word my whole life? Hello. We finally meet. And it was like a gift, the knowledge of just knowing that it was such a validating moment. And I thought, I didn't even realize how much I had needed the term. And it's, you think, oh, it's just a word, or, you know, you can be what you want and not have a word attached to it. But it's not the case when you feel strange your whole life. I knew it would be very misunderstood in Japan, because the discussion around things like that is it's just not really quite there.
Was that part of the reason why you wanted to do it, even in your subconscious, that you could actually then amplify the conversation and help bring greater awareness to what it actually means to you and therefore to others who might feel misunderstood and or isolated?
Well, yes, exactly. There was such a lack of visibility, and anyone, well, the whole idea that gender identity is a thing, like the concept of that, I don't see it really being discussed in Japan. And I just felt it was a bit of a sense of responsibility. And people are scared of, you know, losing the support and love of their families or losing their jobs and things like that. And I don't have to worry about those things. I'm just a public image, basically. So I thought I should. And then afterwards, it felt really good.
I'd love to talk about why you decided to come back and make music when you had ultimately decided that you needed to go and live your life. And at what point during that break you started to feel inspired, whether it was just before you returned or whether you always were always writing and creating, and what that experience felt like. Because as I said at the beginning of our conversation, very few artists I've ever interviewed have walked away for that period of time, being that open and come back and being able to be that successful again.
What was scary was there was this inertia building up. Like it was like being a part of a machine, and I couldn't stop. Because other people, it would affect a lot of people. And scarier was the feeling that the image that people have of me, I become aware of it. And then over time, it just felt like that was growing so much and I couldn't do anything about it. And it was messing with how I look at myself. But when I lived in Japan, before I took the long break, I had never opened my own bank account. I had never done a contract for a mobile phone. I'd never rented a place by myself. I never paid the bills. They were done, like, I don't know who was doing it, honestly. It was like, I guess someone in my management company or people around me, like, or they, someone would like bring me food. This is before, you know.
Of course, because life's work is bad for business. It's all a distraction of what you need to be
like,
doing.
No, you don't need to like waste your energy on these like worldly, you know, little things.
I understand, and with the greatest of respect, what the term J-pop means. And I understand your standing within the J-pop environment as being one of, if not the preeminent pop star of the last two decades. But I have to ask you, what that term means to you now that you've come out this period of living your life in different parts of the world, collaborating with artists from all over the world, and putting out an album that, to me, and again, no disrespect, because genres and terms are important, but this is just a brilliant modern club orientated pop record for me.
I've never really listened properly to much J-pop, and I still don't really know what's going on in J-pop, so I don't think I've been influenced much. I don't see myself as something that has risen from J-pop. But people have said, oh, like the J-pop queen. And then I don't really understand what J-pop means.
That's what I mean. Yours is such a weird success. I mean, I mean every word of that. Zero justification for that statement. I mean, it's for you to have had the kind of unprecedented success that you have had and continue to reach an audience, and yet you, to me, are an outlier. You are a DIY story. You're someone who made your own music on your own terms, reluctantly and eventually walked into a collaborative space when the time was right, deliberately chose to walk away from an unprecedented success to go open a bank account. It's every step you take, just to me, is the step of a unapologetic individualist.
I think I really have to thank my mother for it, though, because I think everything I know about being an unapologetic individualist probably comes from having watched her as I was growing up. And she walked away from a very successful career as a singer and moved to New York, well, to America, eventually New York, and that's where she met my father. And that's how I was born. But I saw how beautiful a life carried out with that attitude is. So I think it has rubbed off on me. Yeah, I can't imagine living any other way.